Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised.
Praise Him.
Every day I will praise Him and give Him all the glory.
Praise Him.
From the rising of the sun to the setting of the same,
praise
the name of Jesus is worthy to be praised. We sing.
Stand. It's good to see you here this morning at Anthony Grow Baptist Church. Welcome, welcome to this place this morning. Find some folks and tell them how wonderful it is to see them here today.
Thank you.
seated.
Amen. And we thank God for the Lord Jesus Christ, who is the light of the world. And you and I have an opportunity at various times to share that light with our world. And Steve Dobbins is going to come at this time and share with you an opportunity that you will have in a few weeks to show the light of the Lord Jesus Christ to those who are in a dark place at this time.
I tried to be up here so I wouldn't have to come walking up in the middle, and I got caught up singing two songs. One I never heard before. Of course, I knew about Hank Williams. I knew the other one, so I was good there. In your bulletin, on the blue sheet, there's an opportunity for you to go and help with disaster recovery from Hurricane Florence. Next Sunday afternoon, we're going to leave and drive to Rocky Point, North Carolina, to do disaster recovery activities there. We'll be staying at the Riley's Creek Baptist Church in Rocky Point. We're going to leave Sunday afternoon, get there around 7 or something along those lines, and then we'll work through Thursday and then come home Thursday evening. Right now, there are three people that are signed up on the list out there in the hallway. I talked with the lady that's the administrator there for that site. She said they could handle 40 to 50 people. We had that many to come. So if you would like to go, you hadn't run out of time yet. I know we said last week we needed to know right away, and that was just so we could get some number in there, get registered, and get a number in there so they could assign us a spot to go. Well, now I have that spot, Rocky Point, North Carolina. So if you'd like to go, my phone number's in there. Call me. Let me know you want to be part of the team. And we're going to leave around 3 o'clock next Sunday afternoon. So if you're interested and want to go and can go, all you retirees, I'm retired now too. I know how this works. You know, you can change your schedule with the drop of a hat. If you don't believe me, all you need is grandchildren, and you'll find out you can. So if you'd like to go, be a part of that effort. You don't have to have any skill. All you need to be able to do is be willing to go and work. That's all it takes. So if you're interested, my contact number's there. I'd love to have 100, so they had to send us 2 places if we could. But if you're interested, please contact me and let me know. The lady's going to call me back Tuesday morning. We're going to finalize our plan. So you got a day to think about it, a day to get off of work if you need to. Just call and let me know by Monday evening, and we'll go from there. Okay? Thank you so much.
Serve the Lord by helping those that are in the path of a hurricane to help them rebuild. Someone just came, Tim just told me that if you have a silver F-250 Ford truck that it has been left running out there, and if that's you, when we pray, you can slip out and no one will know that it was you that left your truck running, okay? It's good to have you in God's house today. Thank you so much for being with us on this Sunday before Thanksgiving. I hope many of you will have an opportunity this coming week to celebrate what God has done in your life with family and loved ones. Thank you for being here to share this day of Thanksgiving with the church family. You'll see lots of opportunities in your bulletin that are coming up this week and weeks to come. I hope you'll take time to look over those and take advantage of all of those that you can. I would point out to you that if you'll look in your order of service, there are 2 offerings today. We will receive a regular offering for our ongoing expenses, and there is a treasure chest up here to my left on your right that every year on the Sunday before Thanksgiving, we take up a special harvest offering. And what we will do at that time is instead of the ushers coming to you, you'll get out of your seat, march up here, put your offering in the chest. And, of course, it's biblical. We'll read about it in a moment in the book of Chronicles where Joash made a chest. The people brought their offering for the building and refurbishing of the temple. Our goal is to be able to pay for these new facilities, pay them off at least 15 years in advance. And we will do that by every year taking a harvest offering. Now, what my wife and I choose to do is next week, We will start saving a little bit every week for next year's offering so that we're able to be generous on this day because we have planned all week. I hope that you will start doing that next Sunday as well. And then if you'll look inside your bulletin, you'll find one of these. It's a connection card. If you'll take it out, fill out the front side. On the back side, there's a place to write down your prayer concerns. I have filled out the whole back side of mine. I hope you'll take an opportunity and do that. At the end of the service, the ushers will bring these up here. Pastor Ken will lead us in praying for all of these. We'll make a prayer list that we give out to the church every week. I hope that you'll take that time to fill out yours. For those of you that are visiting with us today, let me ask you to fill out yours, but to hold on to it. And then at the end of the service, as you're exiting out of the lobby on the right-hand side, I'll be over there at the hospitality table. If you'll bring me your connection card, I'll make sure it gets turned in and prayed over. But I have an information packet and also have a gift I'd like to give you, so I hope you'll come by and see me on your way out. This time we want to ask God to bless our service, bless this time, if you'll join your heart with mine as we pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, at this time of the year, we as a country stop and give thanks to you for all of your blessings. But God, the truth of the matter is every day is a day of thanks. Because every day, God, we enjoy your goodness, your love, your mercy. And so, God, thank you. Thank you for loving us. Thank you, God, for all the things that you bless us with. Lord, we confess today that we are unworthy of all of these blessings, that they're not based on our goodness, but, God, on your goodness. And, Lord, may you pour out your grace and mercy on this service. Lord, may you inspire us, renew us, refresh us, revive us, O God. Deep down in the inner person. And Lord, we'll be sure to thank you and to praise you for all the things that you do in our life. For it's in Jesus Christ's name that we do pray. Amen.
Let's all stand again. You know, the word tells us it's fitting and good to praise his name. Amen. We've done that this morning. Let's continue. Let's rise up this morning and praise his name.
Rejoice, let the earth be glad, let the people of God sing his praise all over the land, everyone in the valley, come and lift your voice, all those on the mountaintop be glad and shout for the Holy One with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. Rise up and praise him.
Put your hands together this morning.
Let the heavens rejoice. Let the earth be. Worship the Holy.
Of our love. He is so deserving of everything that he has done for us. We're in a season of thanksgiving, and I don't know about you, but I want to thank him this morning for the very breath that I can breathe. He got me up. He got you up this morning. Let's worship him this morning.
Standing on this mountaintop, looking just how far we've come, knowing that for every step you were with us. Kneeling on this battleground, seeing just how much you've done, knowing every victory is your power in us. Storms and struggles on say, yes, our hearts can say, never once did we ever walk alone, never once did you leave us on our own. You are faithful, God, you are your power in us. Storms and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, yes, our hearts can say. Never once did we ever walk alone. Never once did you leave us on our own. Your power in us.
you. Thank you, Jesus, for the power, for the power.
Amen. Praise God for the victory that we have in the Lord Jesus Christ and for the promise that He will never leave us nor forsake us. In Luke's gospel, we read, as Jesus looked up, He saw the rich putting their gifts into the temple treasury. He also saw a poor widow put in two very small copper coins. Truly, I tell you, He said, this poor widow has put in more than all the others. All these people gave their gifts out of their wealth, but she, out of her poverty, put in all she had to live on. Let us pray.
Our Heavenly Father, Lord, I just want to thank you for this day. Lord, I just want to thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, who died on Calvary. And Lord, I just thank you for the breath that you give us to get up and come into your house. Lord, this is going to be a awesome day, Lord, that we just come to give the offering back to you, Lord, that's already yours. And Lord, I just pray that anyone here, Lord, that don't know you, I just pray that they don't leave here not knowing. Lord, I do pray for the pastor, Lord, that he is going to bring us a message that you've laid on his heart, Lord. And I do pray, Lord, that the message would touch us. And Lord, I just pray as we leave here, you'll give us a safe journey home to the next appointing time. And Lord, I just ask all these things in Jesus Christ's precious name. Amen. Amen.
When Gina and I chose this song, we've had it for over a year. And sometimes, especially when she and I sing together, we try to choose songs that fit the moment of wherever we're singing. And our lesson, our Sunday school lesson, and what the pastor's been talking about in the songs that we sang this morning is basically saying to keep our eyes on the cross. And you know, we go through a lot of diversity in our life, and sometimes we just want to give. Even though we have God in our heart, we just want to give and say, I've had enough. And we think that there's no good outcome. And I can tell you that when we were still living at the Outer Banks and I was on the pain pills and we lost our home and lost both vehicles and we didn't even have a place to go. And I wanted to give. I'd had enough. And I'd prayed for 2 years to come off of the pain pills I'd been on for 9. And one day I had enough. And I put a gun in my mouth and my wife called and wanted to know what I was doing. So many of you here are going through loss of loved ones, are going through cancer, all kind of things that we just want to give. This morning we're going to sing a song called I Still Glory in the Cross. And Gene and I have talked about this, and we want to dedicate this song to Peggy Johnson this morning.
Oh,
Amen. For the cross of Jesus Christ. We don't earn our salvation. We can't pay God back. But we have this life and all eternity to say thank you, Jesus, for what you have done. And we have at this time an opportunity to give God thanks. What we're doing today is based on 2 Chronicles chapter 24. At the king's command, that's King Joash, a chest was made and placed outside. Unfortunately, we had to place it on the inside today. If we placed it outside, people carry it off. But notice it is at the gate of the temple of the Lord, and a proclamation was then issued in Judah and in Jerusalem that they should bring to the Lord the tax that Moses, the servant of God, had required of Israel in the wilderness. All the officials and all the people brought their contributions gladly, dropping them into the chest until it was full. I want to give God glory and praise that for the last 3 years that we've done this, that God's people have given gladly and generously, and we have filled this chest and received a miracle offering. And we'll ask God to do it again today. Join me as we pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, when we pause and realize that everything that we have comes from the Father of lights who gives us all of the good gifts in our life, Lord, we have an opportunity now to give to the work of God as it relates to the house of God. And Father, I pray that as we give, that we will give gladly, that we will give generously, and that Jesus will be glorified and magnified by our giving. Thank you, Father, for all that you have done, all that you are doing, and all that you're going to do. In Jesus Christ's name, amen. This time we're going to ask you to come and place your harvest offering here in the chest. If you look inside your bulletin, you'll find an outline of today's message, Let Us Give Thanks. And it comes from 1 Chronicles chapter 16. If you look there in your message outline, it'll have the scripture looked up for you. The scripture will also be up here on the screen. And I'm going to ask all that are able to please stand to do so at this time as we honor the reading of God's Word. On that day, David gave to Asaph and his fellow Levites this song of thanksgiving to the Lord. Give thanks to the Lord and proclaim his greatness. Let the whole world know what he has done. Sing to him. Yes, sing his praises. Tell everyone about his wonderful deeds. Exult in his holy name. Rejoice, you who worship the Lord. Search for the Lord and for his strength, and continually seek him. Remember the wonders he has performed, his miracles, and the rulings he has given. And then in verse 29, ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come before him. Worship the Lord in the splendor of his holiness. And then in verses 34 through 36, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Cry out, save us, O God, our Savior. Gather us and deliver us from the nations, that we may give thanks to your holy name, that we may glory in your praise. Praise be to the Lord, the God of Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. Then all the people said, Amen and praise the Lord. Let us pray. Gracious God, we do come today to give you thanks. God, you have been so good to us. God, we come now and honor and glorify your name, for it's in Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. Amen. This coming week is a national holiday. It is Thanksgiving Day. It's one of my favorite holidays. And let me tell you why I really like Thanksgiving. Is somehow Wall Street has not figured out a way to commercialize Thanksgiving. And that's why I enjoy Thanksgiving so much. Thanksgiving has been observed in the United States for 357 years. It started back in the 1600s when in 1660 in Plymouth, England, a group of 102 pilgrims set sail on a wooden vessel called the Mayflower, heading to the New World with the purposes of establishing a colony where they would have religious freedom to worship God according to their conscience. Well, it took them a little over 2.5 months. I don't know about you, but the idea of riding in a small boat in a big ocean for 2.5 months does not excite me. Well, they didn't have GPS and all of that. They didn't have diesel engines. They had to just trust the wind. Well, they ended up much farther north than they had anticipated. And they got here later than they anticipated. And so the Pilgrims and the Mayflower landed at Plymouth Rock on December the 21st. Now think about that. How would you like to be in Massachusetts 4 days before Christmas? It was cold. It's in the dead of winter. There's nothing growing. There's nothing to eat. There's not much you can do to get ready for winter because you're right there in the middle of it. In less than 3 months, that is before March of 1661, half of the pilgrims that came over on the Mayflower had died. And it didn't look good for the remaining 53 pilgrims. Now, you can think this is coincidence, but I believe it's the providence of God. A local Indian there went and got another Indian by the name of Squanto. And Squanto came to the pilgrims, taught them how to plant corn and how to live off of the land. You see, Squanto spoke English. Now, what would be the chances of finding an American Indian in 1661 that spoke English? Squanto had been captured by the English and sold as a slave and learned the English language as a slave and then escaped from slavery and made it back to the colonies and just happened to be at Plymouth Rock. Taught them how to plant and live off the land. And so that fall, 53 pilgrims and 90 Native American Indians came together for 3 days to celebrate the blessings of God. That was the first Thanksgiving in the United States. Well, Thanksgiving would be observed in the United States for 201 more years before it became a national holiday. Do you know when it became a national holiday? In the middle of the Civil War. In 1863, Abraham Lincoln declared the fourth Thursday in November to be a national holiday. But notice the first Thanksgiving, half the people had died. Notice when it becomes a national holiday that America's in the worst world that it would ever experience. More people died, Americans died in the Civil War than any war we have ever faced. And yet in the midst of tragedy, people found time to thank God. Here's what I've observed. Many times we are thankful when times are hard, more so than we are when things are good. Because in the hard times, it reminds us of the good times. You see, you can't really appreciate being warm until you've been cold. And by the way, that's what I was doing a while ago. I was turning the heat down. We're still trying to work out all the details of this new facilities. And how hot to keep the thermostat on is one of them we hadn't figured out yet. You pray about that. Well, today we're going to look at Thanksgiving from three angles. The first angle I want you to see is the problem of Thanksgiving. In verse 8, it says, "Give thanks to the Lord, call on His name, make known among the nations what He has done." I say the problem of Thanksgiving because, you see, it's not natural for us to give thanks. We are by nature, selfish people. We have inherited that from Adam's sin. So the first thing I want you to see is by nature, we are not a thankful lot. In verse 29, as the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord was entering the city of David, Michal, daughter of Saul, watched from a window. And when she saw King David dancing and celebrating, she despised him in her heart. The Ark of the Covenant represented the presence of God. It represented the blessings of God. And David is being able to bring the Ark of the Covenant into the city of Jerusalem. He is so excited. He is praising God. He has broke out in song. He has broke out in dance. And his wife looks outside and she despises what he is doing. You'd think she'd be happy. You think she'd be happy that her husband was happy. You think she'd be happy that the presence and the blessings of God was coming to their town. But no, she despised his celebration of Thanksgiving. By nature, we're not thankful people. Many of you are aware that I have a little grandson. He's cute as a button. And his parents, every time someone gives little Isaac something, they will say to him, "Now what do you say?" Now, about half the time, he'll go ahead and say, thank you. But sometimes he needs a prompting, okay? And sometimes you and I, as adults, we need prompting in order to be thankful in what we do. Notice here what it says in Romans 1:21. For although they knew God, they neither glorified him as God nor gave thanks to him. It's just not natural to be thankful. And so it's something that we learn. It is something we cultivate. It is something that we develop in our life. In 1924, you'd go to school for 8 years, and that was called grade school. And then you'd go to high school starting at the ninth grade and go through the 12th grade. So after finishing 8 grades, they had a graduation service. You have to realize, in 1924, not many people made it through grade school. My grandfather made it to the third grade. I can understand this story. And so when he graduated to eighth grade, young Johnny received a card from his father. His dad's name, Joshua. And his dad put in there a creed for living. And he gave him 3 instructions. In this card, here's what he told little Johnny to do. He said, number one, drink deeply from good books, especially the Bible. Secondly, he said, make every day a masterpiece. Number three, he said, pray every day for guidance and give thanks to God for your blessings. That's a pretty good thing to write for any age. But here's this young boy, 13 years of age. He gets this card, takes it to heart, and puts it into practice. Well, what happened to young Johnny? He grew up to be John. He went to the University of Purdue, where he was a 3-time All-American athlete. Majored in English. Became a high school coach and English teacher. He was good at what he did and became a college coach. He was good at what he did and was offered a job at UCLA. At UCLA, John led the Bruins to 10 national championships in 12 years. He went on a feat that has not been matched when they won 88 games in a row. Nobody has ever come close to what John Wooden did. But if you'd go back to John and say, what is the secret of your success? He would go back and he'd say, it would be the advice of my father and that I did those 3 things every day. What was the 3rd thing? I'm going to pray and ask for guidance and thank God every day for his blessings. Notice here, instead of being thankful, we have a tendency to complain. Nobody's complained about it being too hot this morning. Philippians 2:14. Do everything. What does that leave out? Nothing. Do everything without complaining or arguing. What'll happen is we'll say, oh God, it's so hot outside. And then a couple months later we'll say, oh God, it's so cold. I can't wait for it to get warm again. Now, I probably shouldn't say this the week of Thanksgiving, but we'll say something like, I'm so hungry, I'm about to starve to death. And an hour later, it's, oh God, I ate so much, I'm so full. I can't believe I ate the whole thing. We say, oh man, it's so dry, it needs to rain. Nobody has complained about all the rain last week, huh? Oh, Lord, would you just let it stop raining? Would the sunshine just come out for a day? You see, by nature, we complain and grumble. Notice here what Corinthians 10:10 says about it. And do not grumble. How many times does God have to say that before we get it? And do not grumble as some did and were killed by the destroying angel. Whew, I'm glad God doesn't kill everybody that grumbles and complains now, aren't you? But what is he referring to in this text, the Apostle Paul? The defining moment for the Jewish people was the Exodus when God delivered them from bondage. They had been in slavery for 400 years. Think about that. They were slaves longer than Europeans have been in America. longer than the pilgrims have been here. They'd been slaves. God sent Moses and delivered the people. And as they came out of slavery, God did a miracle. He opened up the Red Sea. They walked across on dry land. They saw the mighty Egyptian army destroyed. When they came into the wilderness, God would rain down bread from heaven every day, manna. When they were out there and they didn't have anything to drink, Moses struck a rock and the best tasting water you've ever tasted came out of a rock. I mean, they experienced miracle after miracle after miracle. And what was their response? They grumbled and complained. There was one guy by the name of Korah, and he complained. And so what God did is he took Korah and his followers and had an earthquake, and just the earth just swallowed them up. Well, guess what? The people still didn't get it. So God sent a plague, and people started dying like flies. And God said, "Get out of the way, Moses, so I can just strike all these people down dead." But instead, Aaron went to the tabernacle and made an offering to God, and the plague was stopped. But 14,700 people died because of their grumbling and complaining. The problem of Thanksgiving. Oh, but it gets worse. Notice here, sinners, who would that be? Us, have a sense of entitlement. In Luke 15:12, the younger son said to his father, "Father, give me my share of the estate." So he divided his property between them. This man had two sons. The younger son says, "Give me my share." What he's really saying is, "Father, I wish you'd hurry up and die so I could get your money." And so his father, being a generous, loving, caring, gracious person, went ahead and gave him his inheritance. Why? He had this sense of entitlement. Give me what is mine. Folks, you understand it wasn't his, it was the father's. The father could have given it to anyone he wanted to. The father could have given it to a beggar or a homeless person. It was the father's, it wasn't his. But notice he had this sense of entitlement. I see people all today who think that God owes them something. Let me tell you what we deserve for our sins. We deserve to die and go to a devil's hell. That's what we deserve. That's what we're entitled to. But God gives us grace and mercy and love instead. But let me tell you how bad it is, this sense of entitlement. In 2011, on September the 11th, Amanda Clayton, 24 years old, won the Michigan lottery for $1 million. Now, she could have got $1 million over 20 years, so she could get a one-time lump sum of $700,000. So if you were 24 years old, what would you do? She took the lump sum. And then after taxes, it was a little over $500,000. That's not chump change, is it? Several months later, Amanda is seen in a grocery store checking out and paying for her groceries with food stamps. A reporter asked her, "Does it not bother you that you are buying your groceries with food stamps and you just won $1 million? Here's what this 24-year-old said, okay? She says, "No, I don't have a problem. I get $200 a month in food stamps, and I use it to buy groceries. You see, right now, I don't have a job, and I have two houses that I have to take care of." Now, folks, I don't know about you, but when you're 24 years old and you own two houses, you don't need to be getting food stamps, okay? You have $500,000 in the bank, and yet she felt like that she was owed this. Do you understand the federal government can't give you anything unless they take it away from somebody else? I mean, the government doesn't produce any goods. take from this group and give it to that group. But she felt entitled to it as a perfect picture of a sinner before a gracious God. So the first angle I want us to see is the problem of thanksgiving. And the second angle I want you to see is the person of thanksgiving. Notice there in verse 8, give thanks to the Lord, call on his name, make known among the nations what he has done. You see, thanksgiving's all about a person. It's not about a bird. It's not Turkey Day, it's Thanksgiving Day. It's not about family, it's about God. Thanksgiving is about a person. Notice there, give thanks to the Lord. The pilgrims, what did they do? They thanked God for their religious freedom. You know, I just have a sense of humor. And I just wonder about atheists. What did they do on Thanksgiving? I mean, if Thanksgiving is all about thanking God for our blessings, who does the atheist thank? Just a thought. Well, let's give thanks to God. Notice here, give thanks to God because he's good. In verse 34, give thanks to the Lord for he is good, his love endures forever. Did you know if there's anything good in your life, God did it? Did you know if there's anything good in your life, God gave it? You see, God is a good, good God, and he gives good gifts to his children. Psalm 27, verse 13 says, I'm still confident of this. I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. You know, there's good all around us if you just have eyes to see it. I want you to think about your local news. When you watch the local news, whether it's Channel 3 or Channel 9 or Channel 36, when you watch the local news, how much of the news is bad news? When you watch the national news, how much of it's bad news? But notice there, he said, I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. I'm convinced they don't have good news on television because the goodness of the Lord does not make for high ratings in television. But God is good. And let's thank God for being a good, good God. Ray Steadman tells a story about Harry Ironside. Harry Ironside was a great Bible scholar. And he was having a meal with this man. And when he came to the table, he sat down. The fellow started eating. And Harry Ironside just dropped his head, bowed his head. And he had his head bowed for a little while, and then he looked up, and his host said to him, he said, Harry, is something wrong? He said, no. Harry, do you have a headache? He said, no. He said, Harry, is there something wrong with the food? He said, no. He said, why'd you have your head all slumped over? He said, oh, I always stop and give thanks to God for my food before I eat. And this man said to Harry Ironside, why, I never do that. I earn my own bread. I just dive right in. And Harry Ironside said, yep, just like my dog. But notice here his attitude. His attitude was, as I earn my own bread. Did you know you can't get up unless God wakes you up? Did you know you can't think unless God gives you thoughts? Did you know you can't breathe unless God gives you a breath of air? And so everything in your life is because of a good, good God. And then secondly, give thanks to God because he's loving. In verse 34, give thanks to the Lord for he is good, his love endures forever. Now I don't want to bring up an unpopular subject at this time. But everybody in this room can probably think of somebody that used to love them that doesn't love them anymore. Can't you? But you see, notice here, the Bible says his love endures forever. You see, God loves you with an everlasting love. God loves you when you're bad. God loves you when you're good. And God loves you in between. You see, God's love is based on who he is, not on what you do. Lamentation says it this way. Because of the Lord's great love, we're not consumed, for his compassions never fail. How much does God love you? You ever asked a little child that? How much you love me? And they spread out their hands and say, I love you this much. I love you this much. Would you understand 2,000 years ago on an old Roman cross, Jesus stretched out his arms and said, God loves you this much. And so we thank God for his love. And then number three, thank God because of his faithfulness. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. You see, if God just loved you for a moment, it wouldn't be all that great. But God loves you forever. God is faithful. He will never leave you. He will never forsake you. God will never disappoint you. God will never let you down. God is faithful. Lamentations says, they are new every morning. That's the graces and mercies of God. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. Wouldn't it be nice if you and I were as faithful as God? I'm reminded of a dedicated, decorated war hero who became a four-star general, was the leader of the Afghanistan war, became the director of the CIA. And because of pride, he was writing a book. He had a biographer that was writing the book with him that David Petraeus got caught up in an affair, was discovered by the FBI. He was outed publicly and had to resign in disgrace. After being married for 37 years, he became unfaithful. Aren't you glad that after 37 years, God doesn't become unfaithful? Aren't you glad that after 100 years, God doesn't become unfaithful? That God's love endures forever and ever and ever. God is faithful. And then the third angle I want us to look at is the practice of thanksgiving. How can you and I show thanksgiving? Notice what it says in verse 35. Cry out, save us, O God, our Savior. Gather us and deliver us from the nations, that we may give thanks to your holy name, that we may glorify in your praise. You understand, thanksgiving is not something you say. Thanksgiving is something that you do. Has he saved you? Has he redeemed you? Has he washed away your sins? And the Bible says, then give him thanksgiving. How should we do that? Number one, let my thanks be powerful. Verse 36, praise the Lord, the God of Israel, who lives from everlasting to everlasting. And all the people whispered, amen, and praised the Lord. They didn't whisper. What did they do? They shouted. Notice here, their praise was powerful. And so here they are. They're shouting, amen, praise the Lord, hallelujah. They're blowing trumpets. They're clashing cymbals. I want you to contrast that with this idea today that we're supposed to come into God's house and be still and to be quiet. They made a commotion as they showed thanksgiving to God. I love how verse 8 says it. David and all the Israelites were celebrating with all of their might before God, with songs, with harps, with lyres and tambourines and cymbals and trumpets. You understand what they're doing? They're making their praise powerful. Where's Delia? Delia? One of the translations that I read says that they played the harp loudly. Now, you know, I can imagine that the drums are easy to play loud. I can imagine the guitar is easy to play loud. The trumpet is easy to play loud. But Delia, they had to do some strumming to play a loud harp. But notice here, they did this in a powerful, joyous manner. I have this quote from G. Campbell Morgan. I want you to let it sink in. Lukewarmness is the worst form of blasphemy. Lukewarmness is the worst case of blasphemy. And then he tells why. He says, it means God doesn't excite you. Woo! Now let that sink in, folks. God doesn't excite you enough to get loud and proud. Now you can go on Friday night to a West Lincoln ball game and get loud and proud, but you can't do it when you're in the house of God with the people of God celebrating the goodness of God. Lukewarmness is the worst form of blasphemy. Does God excite you? You remember when you first got saved? Remember how excited you were? Well, what's happened since then? You ought to be more excited now because you ought to better understand what God has done for you. And then secondly, let my thanks be intentional. That day, David first committed to Asaph and his associate this psalm of thanks to the Lord. Now that word there, committed, is an interesting word. In the Hebrew, it literally means to cast. To cast. Now I don't know about you, but when I think about casting, I think about fishing. So let's just say we're going to go fishing. We go down to the lake, we go down to the river, we get out our pole, we get out our bait, we hook it all up. You know, we have our Lance crackers and we have our Diet Coke and, you know, we're all sitting there to catch fish. It doesn't do any good till you cast that rod and reel, does it? I mean, all the other preparations don't mean a thing until you do what? Until you cast it. And so notice here, he committed this psalm, this song of thanksgiving. Now, I don't know about you, but here's what I've discovered about fishing. When I'm going to cast, I take aim at where I'm going to cast. And so the Bible says that we should be intentional about our thanksgiving. It's not just saying, oh, I'm thankful. It's not just saying I'm blessed, but I am thankful unto God. Let the world know who we are thankful to. It should be intentional. And then number three, let my thanks be continual. In verse 23, sing to the Lord, all the earth, proclaim his salvation. One day a week. Doesn't say that, does it? It says day after day. In other words, I'm to be thankful today, thankful tomorrow, thankful yesterday, day after day. My thanks is to be continual. I read an interesting story a couple years ago about a German Shepherd dog. I guess I remember it because I have a German Shepherd dog. The name of this dog is called Capitan. Its owner lived in Argentina, bought this German Shepherd, had it for a year, and then suddenly this man died and was buried. The day after the funeral, his dog, this German Shepherd, Capitan, got missing. 2 days later, the family goes to the cemetery where the man was buried, and there was the dog at the tomb at the place the man was buried. Now, the dog didn't go to the cemetery. How they found it, they don't know. So anyhow, they took the dog back home. The next morning, the dog gets gone. They get to looking for it. Guess where it's at? At the cemetery. And according to the New York Daily News, this dog has gone back to that gravesite every day for 6 years in a row. And when I read that, it convicted me. I said, I will not let a dog be more faithful to his dead master than I will be to my living master. Let's give thanks and praise to God continually today, this coming week, and every day give thanks to God. And then number four, let my thanks be universal. Verse 36, praise the Lord, the God of Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. When am I supposed to thank God? All the time. How long am I going to do it? Forever and ever. 1 Thessalonians 5:18 says, give thanks in all circumstances, For this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. I want you to look at that verse. God didn't say give thanks for all circumstances. Some circumstances are not very pleasant. But in the unpleasant circumstances of life, in those circumstances, I'm going to thank God in the midst of cancer. I'm going to thank God in the midst of sickness. I'm going to thank God in the midst of difficulty and trouble. Did you know anybody can praise God when they're on a mountaintop? But your most powerful witness is when you can thank and praise God in the valley. Because then a lost and dying world takes notice and said, how can you do that? And then we have an opportunity and turn around and say, it's not me that does it, it's God in me that does it. I want to close by telling you a true story. Bob Reichard had a severe spinal injury. I don't know what that's like. I know my wife's had multiple spinal back surgeries. And I've been told you really don't know what it's like to be down till you're down in your back. He'd had severe back injury, had surgery, been in the hospital, had been in convalescent, and was sent home in a wheelchair. He took his wheelchair and he rolled it out on the back porch. It was cold. It was windy. It was rainy. It was dreary kind of a day. And he's just sitting out there in that wheelchair feeling sorry for himself. And you know what God did? God sent a little songbird to perch right there on the guardrail. And in this nasty, cold, windy, dreary weather, that little bird just broke out in the most beautiful song. And warmed up this man's heart. He went back inside. The next day, the sun came out. He rolled out there on the back porch. It's warm. The sun is shining. It's a beautiful day. And he's sitting there. And guess what? That same little old bird flies right back. Lights on that rail and starts singing the most beautiful song all over again. And in the midst of that song, God spoke to Bob. And here's what he said to Bob. He said, notice that bird's song is not based on his circumstances. Instead, it's a song that's on the inside of his heart. And friend, I want you to know if Jesus Christ has saved you, if he's washed away your sins, if he's adopted you into his family, if he's building you a home in heaven, you got a song in your heart. No matter what the circumstances of life, you can praise God for what he has done in your heart and what he's going to do in your life. I'm going to ask you to bow your head. Nobody's looking around. It is true that confession is good for our soul. I'm wondering who would get out of their seat and come to this altar and say, God, you've been so good to me. And Lord, by nature, I grumble and complain. And God, I recognize that that does not bring you honor and glory. So Lord, I come today to ask you to cultivate within me a heart of praise, a heart of thanksgiving, a heart overflowing with praise to your glory. Now, you and I can praise God because God has saved us and put a song in our heart. If you're here today and you have never made that faith commitment to Jesus Christ, when you say, God, I'm a sinner, come into my heart, wash away my sins, God, adopt me into your family, I can't think of a better time than right now for you to make that faith commitment. If you just simply come and say, God, have mercy on me, a sinner, I'm trusting Jesus right now, God will do the rest. I'm wondering who's here today and you'd come and say, God, I want to give thanksgiving every day. I want my thanks to be powerful, continual, intentional, and universal. Lord, make me an instrument of your praise. Heavenly Father, God, you are a good God. You're a loving God. You're a faithful God. You are worthy of our praise. You are worthy of our thanksgiving. Forgive us, God, when we have focused on our circumstances instead of focusing on you. God, put a song in our heart that the world cannot dampen. Put a song in our heart, God, that will magnify and glorify your Son, Jesus Christ. Lead us now, God, as we make our commitments and our decisions. We'll make our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Go ahead, please stand as we sing. We invite you to come. Be seated. Pastor Ken's going to come up here and share our prayer concerns and lead us in our closing prayer. As he comes, I want to remind you tonight we'll have a Thanksgiving service. We'll have the Lord's Supper. We have six different people who are going to give testimonies. You want to be here to hear what God has done in their hearts and their lives, and remind you that Wednesday we will not have service or anything else because people will be getting ready for Thanksgiving.
Thank you, Pastor. Several requests of prayer we call your attention to today. Miss Thelma Martin is sitting right here this morning. We're glad that she's with us. She's had surgery. We appreciate Thelma. Robin Davini, is in good spirits. She's got good flow in that foot, hopefully that things are going to be all right. She's going to save the foot, so God has heard and answered prayer there. We're praying for Brenda Rash. Hold up your hand, Brenda. There she is. She's had surgery. She's back with us today. We're glad that Brenda is here. Mr. Warren Griggs is in rehab. Charles Badger's in rehab. Praying for Mr. Ken Fowler and Tommy Linhart, Benny Tate, Tina Kester, waiting on treatment. Been asked to pray for Tim Spangler, Tommy Crocker, Sarah Lewis, Peggy Johnson. She's here somewhere. Where are you, Peggy? All right. She's in the roost up there. Glad to see her here this morning. We're praying for Tammy Chapman. God might be with her. Many of you stopped me and asked me about my son, how things are going with Dale. Dale had his first treatment shot this past week. Been a little nauseated, but he did preach last Sunday morning. So pray for Dale that God might undertake. And Cheryl had her hearing about disability this week. And they're going to let her know in 90 days, believe it or not. Just a little delay, you know, been about 4 or 5 years. 90 more days won't hurt, I don't reckon. So I hope you'll pray about that and pray for Cheryl's headaches that God might help her. We've got a lot of requests on our connection cards. If you have a request, would you let it be known? I invite you to pray with me now as we remember these requests. Heavenly Father, in the midst of all our problems, difficulties, sicknesses, deaths, and all that's happening today, we can say thank you, God, for your blessings on me. You're faithful, as the pastor has stated. Lord, we're here today because of that cross that Randy and Gina sang about this morning. And I pray that we'll take the words of that song and this message home with us. And Lord, we'll be a grateful and thankful people for the goodness of God. Thank you, Lord, for our harvest offering, whatever it might be. We give you praise for everybody who has given today, that your blessings will be upon them. Accept our thanks for your goodness to us. Thank you for being with Anthony Grove Church. Continue to keep your hand upon us. Lead us by your Spirit. And may we come back tonight to honor you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Thank you for being here today.